So today in the series of Doc Lex's KOL interviews, we have Dr. Sinu Kumar Bhaskaran, who is an orthopedic and joint replacement surgeon at Columbia Asia Hospital, Pune. So thank you so much for being with us today. So why is the orthopedic society so worried about infections?
You see, Shreyas, orthopedic procedures have mainly metallic implants involved in them, either fixing the bones or replacing certain areas of bones. And the organisms that infect our implants tend to secrete a layer called as biofilm around these infected implants. And what this biofilm does is it prevents antibiotics from getting to that site where the organisms are exactly. So you cannot treat them like normal infections, like giving a course of antibiotics or washing up the joint. So unfortunately, if an orthopedic implant is infected, the whole implant needs to come out, which is not a good scenario for the surgeon as well as for the patient. So we are more obsessed with preventing infections rather than having to deal with them at a later stage.
So as you said that you have to remove the complete implant if there is an infection on it.
Right.
So is there is infection an end to the road of artificial implants?
Not really. With our newer techniques, we do have methods by which we can get back the patient onto a normal kind of situation. What we need to do, like I mentioned before, the implant needs to come out. Then we put in something called as an antibiotic spacer, loaded spacer, for a few weeks, and then we have to go in and then put in a final implant. It's called a revision implant. This is a two-stage procedure involving almost 2 months for the patient. So even though there is a positive outcome for the patient, it does involve a lot of, physical, emotional, and financial burden on the patient. So definitely preventing infections is better.
Sir, as you said that prevention is definitely better than cure. So how can doctors prevent infection, especially when it is related to joint replacements?
Again, for that we need to understand that infection is not just a two-point process where an organism is getting into a wound and multiplying there. It's more of a complex interplay between three factors. That is the host, which is the patient, the organism, of course, and thirdly, the environment, that is the hospital, the OT and the wards, etc. So just by giving antibiotics, we are not preventing infection. So we need to take care of a lot of other factors by which we can prevent infection. So it actually starts, for me, infection prevention starts the moment the patient walks into my OPD office. So the patient evaluation starts at that point, like if he's got diabetes, if he's a patient with rheumatoid arthritis on steroids, if he's a high-risk patient for MRSA infections, if he's got some other focus of infections like urinary tract or ear, nose, throat infections. So all these need to be optimized before I take them up for surgery. So they are investigated and accordingly again further checked by a physician before we actually plan out the date for surgery. So that is the preoperative part. And once the patient is admitted, we need to prepare the patient so as the bacterial load that the patient sheds in the operation theater is brought to a minimum. We do that by doing something called as a preoperative chlorhexidine baths. So that is usually done about 12 hours before the period of surgery, about 2 hours before the period of surgery. It's done twice before the patient is taken up for surgery. I really do not advocate shaving the surgical site of the patient. There is very clear studies that indicate that shaving the patient on the night before surgery can in fact lead to further infections. Once the patient is in your theatre, we need to realize that the maximum amount of organisms that is there in your operating room is shed from the skin of the patient as well as the operating team, that is the surgeon and his team. And the other bacteria is the bacteria that is present within the operating room environment. So all the techniques and modalities go to preventing or reducing this bacterial load. Of course, patient preparation, again, which happens in the operation theater, we like to use chlorhexidine-based solutions to bring down the bacterial load. The operating team, washing up and preparing for surgeries, again, very important. Your gloving techniques, your draping techniques. As far as drapes are concerned, we are very big fans of using disposable drapes. The old, the cotton or the spun weaving fiber used in drapes can again lead to a lot of shedding of bacteria and can cause infections. Besides the patient preparation and the surgeon getting prepared for the surgery, The OT environment is very important, where we have something called as laminar airflow systems, which maintain extremely low amount of bacterial counts within the operating room environment when we are performing the surgery. Then factors like handling the tissues while operating, we need to maintain a, if not very quick surgeries, but there should be a decent time in which you need to complete your surgeries, because very prolonged surgeries again can lead to increased rates of infection. So once the patient is operated and he is shifted out of OT, your infection prevention protocols are still continuing there, like how you handle the patient in the ward. You should be very careful with you know, basic techniques of hand washing, hand scrubbing before you actually touch your patient. As far as dressings are concerned, I do not like to repeatedly handle the wound. I just do one dressing on the day after the surgery and the second dressing the time the patient is getting discharged. So again, these are basic. It's a very generalized guideline as to how we go into preventing infections, and it's not just that antibiotic dosage that we are giving for 4 or 5 days that is going to prevent infections. At Columbia Asia, we are very specific as far as antibiotic use is concerned. We just give a single day of antibiotics, one dose on the morning of the surgery, that is about within 60 minutes of the incision of the surgery. And depending on whether the patient is a single knee, that is a unilateral knee replacement, or a bilateral knee replacement, we either repeat one more dose if it is a unilateral knee replacement, and or we repeat two more doses if it is a bilateral knee replacement, which is of course all given within a period of 24 hours. So we just use about 24 hours of antibiotic prophylaxis, no matter what kind of patient, whether the patient is a diabetic or whether the patient is a rheumatoid. If he's optimized, he just gets 24 hours of antibiotics and not more than that. There's no other oral antibiotic followed up after that as well.
You were just talking about the prolonged use of antibiotics. So what are the negative points that come while serving the prolonged use of antibiotics?
Using prolonged antibiotics, besides the obvious issues like it adds to the financial a strain on the patient, there are the common side effects like abdominal discomfort, nausea and diarrhea when you are using a long-standing course of antibiotics. More recently, microbiologists have come out with this theory that when you give antibiotics for a long period of time, or when you use a very high dose of antibiotics, what it does is it activates or agitates your normal bacterial flora on the skin, and this can then become more active and can lead to infection. So it is better to just give that short course of a very moderate kind of antibiotic just to cover that period and get out of there. Besides these common problems, the greatest risk of prolonged use of antibiotics is the development of antibiotic resistance. Now, antibiotic resistance is not just a problem for the patient. The patient, of course, is going to develop antibiotic resistance, and later on he's going to have problems when he has some other infection. But antibiotic resistance, unfortunately, is disseminated through the community, and once you develop a resistant strain of bacteria, it is easily spread through the community, and that's how the community becomes resistant to a particular antibiotic. So as doctors, we need to be very carefully using antibiotics. What is called as rational antibiotic usage has to be a very important part of our practice as well.
So you were talking about the antibiotic resistance that has developed in the community, and a doctor is a responsible person who should take care of it. So how can a doctor prevent the spread of antibiotic resistance in the community?
Yeah, for that we need to look back at the last century. If you realize the invention or the discovery of penicillin or the discovery of antibiotics as a whole was one of the most significant scientific breakthroughs in the last century. Since 1928, Alexander Fleming had gotten penicillin. Since then, we have had a lot of antibiotics at our disposal, and that's how we have brought in a lot of the infections under control. But at the same time, in 1940, when he got his Nobel Prize for penicillin, he had warned us that there is going to be a day when we are going to lose these antibiotics if we do not take care of them properly, and that's what we are exactly seeing today. The last antibiotic that was discovered was in 1987, and after that, it was just last year we have got one antibiotic, that is Tyxobactam. So during this 20-year period, we've just got one antibiotic, and one new antibiotic, and we have lost about 20 to 25 antibiotics to antibiotic resistance. During my days of education, medical basic medical training, we could use drugs like Ceftran and Ciprofloxacin, which was found to be very effective. And in today's day, we can very clearly see that these are antibiotics that do not work anymore. And the sole reason for that is indiscriminate use of antibiotics, giving very prolonged course of antibiotics, giving antibiotics where it is not needed. Just last year in India, WHO had collected data about pediatric deaths due to antibiotic resistance. So there were almost 58,000 children who had died due to purely antibiotic resistance. Mm-hmm. Now these are children who had your normal abdominal infections or respiratory infections, which could have been very well treated with your normal antibiotics. But antibiotic resistance was obviously a problem for them and it gave them a very bad outcome. So what I want to say is that it's not just an orthopedician who's using another 3 doses of antibiotics or another 4 or 5 days of antibiotics which is leading to a situation like this. But there's a overall multifactorial cause why this is happening. But at the same time, we need to realize that specialists and orthopedicians that at some point when we use more than 4 or 5 days of antibiotics, we are contributing to this problem to some extent. Of course, indiscriminate, there are other factors like indiscriminate use of antibiotics, over-the-counter prescriptions, abuse of antibiotics in the poultry industry. So all this can contribute to antibiotic resistance. But the onus is upon us as specialists or surgeons to take it up, to use minimal antibiotics, to use effective antibiotics. And so we can sort of pass it on as a message to the rest of the medical community. Where we can try and take care of whatever antibiotics we have left with us.
So the antibiotic resistance theory which you have explained us was basically very informative. So like we are glad that you at Columbia Asia use single shot antibiotics. So are there any other practices you practice apart from normal orthopedic and joint replacement?
Mainly we do joint replacements here at Columbia Asia. Besides the routine joint replacements, we have also introduced in quite a few cutting edge practices where we use something called as ISS technology, which is a next generation of computerized knee replacement, wherein we just have to attach a few pods to the knee, and then that transmits data to an iPad that is kept outside, and then I get data feedback from that about my level of cuts that I need to take, at what angle I need to take. So it does 2 things mainly. One, obviously, it increases the accuracy of my cuts. It gives the patient a much better alignment. And secondly, and more importantly, what I can do in this is I do not have to drill bones as I do while using a normal instrumentation. One of the biggest risk factors while doing a knee replacement is when you're drilling into your thigh bone or into the femoral bone, and that can lead to something called as fat embolism, and that is a bit risky for the patient. So that is completely avoided when I'm using a ISS knee replacement.
So like you said that while using the ISS knee, you also make use of your iPad, which gives you a better understanding of cutting edges. So what difference did you notice from shifting over from a normal joint replacement to ISS knee?
It was a stage-by-stage thing. From a normal knee replacement, we went to something called this navigation or a computer navigation knee replacement, which was there. But as you can see in your day-to-day activities, I mean, when we started off with the PC, it used to be a big box that was right in front of us. Similarly, in the operation theatres as well, we had a very big trolley with a big box placed on top of it, with wires passing from the OT table to the box, and that did get in your way. We're not sure whether it led to increased infection, but that of course got in the way of performing surgeries. And like in today's world, we are using iPads and much sleeker forms of PC. Similarly, so we have a much sleeker variant of the computer, which is just an iPad. So the advantage it gives me is mainly it reduces my OT congestion. I have a lesser amount of space taken up by the machine, and definitely the freedom of movement is much more. There are no wires. It is a completely wireless technology, and of course the accuracy has improved with the software as well.